Today we're going to deal with a topic that I don't try to do this too much because sometimes a bunch of false prophets watch us on TV and they watch us on the internet and then they'll try to take some of these scriptures from these lessons and try to fleece the sheep, so to speak, and try to take advantage of people by using the word of God to get money from them. And the word of God is not about making money. The word of God is about getting salvation. And teaching people how to get salvation and not charge them to do it. Whereas you got most of these preachers nowadays, they got their entourages with them. They got to have a certain amount of money before they even come up and show up. And it ain't about that. What the money is for anything is to get the word of God out. Plain and simple. And to take care of the Lord's house of worship. So bottom line is, it's not for no one particular person. It's about him cars and houses and jets and things like that. It's about having the ability to get the word of God out to the people. And that's our job. That's what every time you put something in, you put something toward getting the word of God out. And that's what it's all about. And it takes care of his house. I know it might be a little cooler here today, so I heard some people complain about how cold it is already. It's almost 10 below outside, so come on now. It takes time for Israel's body heat to kick in, but it's going to kick in. But the bottom line is, you sitting in a room where you got heat, right? That takes money. We can't go down to the gas company, people gas, and say, look, we got a whole stock of corn here. Can we trade that for heat? This society don't work on that.
That's right.
And we can't go take no meat there either because you got a lot of congregations out here saying, well, you ain't supposed to pay no money for tithes. It's only supposed to bring fruit and vegetation. We're going to look at that today. Because a lot of things we have to clear up sometimes because it ain't like we're trying to get your money, but in order for us to do the will of God, that money has to be put forth. The Lord started off with it in the beginning, and we're going to show you that, to show you that the Lord, he don't care what he got. He care what you going to bring. We're going to read today, the Lord said he got cattle on 1,000 hills. If he was hungry, he had to tell you. And even we're going to show you that even when him and Peter had to pay tribute, he told Peter to go down to the river, throw a hook in the water. He didn't say use no bait or nothing. He said when the fish come up, get the coin and pay the tribute for us. He know where all the treasures is. He made the world, so what you think you can give him that he don't already own? But he looking at what you can bring forth to show that you have faith and that you're going to do his will and that you respect him. And that's what it's all about. It ain't about what y'all think y'all putting in Brother Marlin's pocket, because you got a lot of people that say, Brother Marlin, he making so much money over there, he doing this, he doing that, he taking his money, doing it, taking it. The church do pay me a little portion, but I will not let the church take care of me fully because I don't trust y'all. That's what it boiled down to. Because if I have to wait on y'all, I don't know. I gotta have me a place to live. That's why I keep my own business going. So sometimes when you call here, you don't get no answers because I'm out working. But when I get back, I can do my work while I'm sitting here, and that's why I get a little portion from the church. So I have to sit in some company's office and do my work. I can sit here and do my work. That's the only benefit that I have from this church. And I do that so I can be here because I'm telling you, when I tried to work 8 hours a day, phone be ringing, going off constantly, people need this, people need this right away, that I just said I couldn't do it no more because it was just too much. The bigger we got, the more demand came. But still, like I said, I dread the day that I have to have y'all pay 100% of my salary. I just dread it. I couldn't sleep at night knowing that somebody may not be there tomorrow. And then what I'm going to do, right? Because, you know, right now, I can still say what's on my mind and don't care if y'all show up anyway, right? But if I got a cow told to y'all because y'all pay me, then it's going to change things. So this way I can stay the way I want to be and not let y'all control me, plain and simple, right? So that's the benefit. And it ain't even 50% of my salary, I'm telling you that. It ain't even 50%. It's just basically to keep me here. That is all. So you got some people out saying, I'm making $100,000 over here. You know, come on. I don't make that with my business with the church. But I make enough to be content and take care of my household. That's all I do. And that's enough for me. I don't need no brand new car. I like these brand new cars because they talk to you. My car ain't said a word to me except I'm broke. But I know those amenities are out there. I ain't striving to get those amenities. I just want to get from point A to point B. get home, sleep, eat comfortably, and I'm good. And I'm comfortable with that. That's what you should be, right? Because the Lord said he ain't gonna put no more on you than you can bear. And if you can bear being rich, then that's what the Lord put on you. But if you can't handle money, the Lord ain't gonna give you money. Because you know you're gonna mess it up and go out there and do something wrong. And then bottom line is you're gonna end up without him. And he ain't gonna give you too little because the book say the Lord ain't none of his servants ever beg bread, right? So we just have to have faith that the Lord gonna take care of us. Because sometimes we can say, oh, I gotta pay this, I gotta pay that. And I'm gonna just pay my tithe next week. I'll pay my tithe next month. And we keep putting things off. And I know people putting things off because then they'll come to me, Brother Marlon, I don't know what's going on in our business and stuff. I ain't going to get involved in your personal business. So all I do is say, what do you need? Because that's what the church is here for, to help you out. Because you put in the kitty. Now, if you don't put in the kitty, and then you call him and say, Brother Marlon, I need some help. I look for your name. I don't see nothing. Then why should we help you? Because I believe churches should take care of their members. I believe that wholeheartedly. But the members got to take care of the church. When people put in the Salvation Army, then the Salvation Army come out and help you, they know because you participate, right? Or you going to participate. Same thing for the church. And I tell you, we have put out more money in assisting people than we got in the bank. And we doing good, bank-wise. I had to call a bank one time and say, hey, y'all still covering us with insurance? Because I was kind of worried we was over the limit. That you know we're not suffering at all here. Because I got people out here saying we going broke with it. Please. We got a building down the street that we don't owe a nickel on. You understand me? So Lord is blessing us because we taking care of the Lord's business. And ain't nothing going in Brother Marlon's pocket except for the little portion he get to stay here 5 days a week. Because I tell you, we get some calls sometime during the week here, and it's a good thing I'm here because we might lose people if somebody here answer that call. Because some people want, matter of fact, a sister called here yesterday, said she'd been having a hard time, and she'd been calling all these Israelite camps, and she never got an answer because the phone was disconnected. She said, we were the first one to ever answer the phone. Why? Because we're here. Been there for a while, and we're going to stay here. No matter if these people call us rebels or, you know, bad or this, that, and the other, if the Lord bless us, we're going to stick with what we got. Because we're going to follow scripture no matter what.
That's right.
Plain and simple. You understand me? So now, let's get past my preaching and get to the lesson. Because it ain't an amen lesson. People don't like to hear it. And I don't like to do it because everybody says, Brother Mark, you talking about me. I'm not talking about you. I'm reading scripture. If the scripture hits you, that's your problem.
That's right?
Right? Because you got a lot of people that benefit off of the Church of Israel or benefit off the Word of God as we teach it, but don't put a dime in the bucket. Oh, we've been following you for 6 years. What's your name? You know, but then, like I said, then we'll get a call and say, well, you know, my rent, I can't pay my rent. Like I say, I look in the book, and I try to help people out. This church tries to help people out as much as we can. But sometimes you don't help the church can't help you. Just that simple, okay? We're going to look at those things because I want to show you the Lord know Israel. And when it comes to money and food, that's what Israel is all about. Get past the emotion because the husband and wife thing, that's always going to be an issue. But money and food is the biggest problem when it comes to Israel. We never think we got enough food, and we never think we got enough money. But we always have a money problem. And the Lord know that, but you got to take care of the Lord first, then he will take care of you. Okay? Now, let's go to Malachi 3rd chapter, because even the New Testament preachers find this in the Old Testament. And there'll be the Old Testament Christian for a day when it comes to this. But anything else, they don't want to go to the Old Testament for. Because they'll argue down, well, that's the Old Testament. That's the Old Testament. Well, then don't go to Malachi 3 and read this to your people to put fear on them. Okay? Malachi 3 and verse 8. Go ahead.
Will a man rob God?
Mm-hmm.
Yet ye have robbed me.
Uh-huh.
But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee?
Mm-hmm.
In tithes and offerings.
The Lord let you know how you rob him. Because if you benefiting from the word of God, you benefiting from the church, and you don't take care of the Lord's business, you robbing him. And how you do it? In tithes and offerings. Okay, go ahead.
Ye are cursed with a curse.
And that's how they put this fear on the people. You are cursed with a curse. You need to bring your money to the church. And they ain't think about nothing but what they can put in the kitty to take care of that, the household of that preacher. But they putting this fear on people. But the Lord is saying you are cursed with a curse. Okay, go ahead.
For ye have robbed me, even this whole nation. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts.
So now, he said, bring your offering to the storehouse. What is the storehouse? The church.
That's right.
And you got brothers here who say, well, they say, you only supposed to bring meat, because that's what it said, right? But you can't take meat and have no contractor coming here and say, look, man, I need you to fix this wall over here. And you give him a steak and say, go ahead. He ain't looking for no steak. He looking for money,
right?
But he said, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be meat in my house. Go ahead.
If I will now open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive.
He said, because if you take care of him, he'll put this blessing on you. And like I said, I know people all the time say, well, I'm going to pay my tithe next week. I'm going to pay my tithe next month. The Lord know how much he's giving you. And he know all you got to do is take a portion off. I ain't going to say it. We're going to read it. A certain portion off and give it to him, and then he'll bless you. But you can't give it grudgingly. I got to pay 10%. I said it anyway.
You might as well kept it.
You might as well have kept it in your pocket.
That's right.
Because you're giving it without rejoicing that you're doing it for the Lord. Because when you know your money is going to take care of the Lord's business, whether it's helping somebody pay rent for a month or helping somebody get out of jail or helping somebody put food on their table, you took care of the Lord's business. And you can't do it right. Okay? Now, let's go to Genesis, the fourth chapter. Because most people think that tithes and offering came up during when the children of Israel came out of Egypt. But it came long, long, long before that. Genesis 4. And verse 1. Go ahead.
And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground.
So now, one was a shepherd keeping animals, and the other one was a farmer. But they both did service and take care of vegetation or animal. Okay, go ahead.
And in the process of time, it came to pass. And Cain brought up the fruit of the ground and offered unto the Lord.
Now, he brought what to the Lord? An offering. Because he wanted to show the Lord that he was doing okay, so he brought an offering. Okay, but go ahead.
And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof.
Now, but Abel's a little different. What did he bring that Cain didn't bring? He brought the best. Then when you bring something before the Lord, he don't want your second hand or your third hand or your hand-me-down or what you don't want. He wants your best. And we're going to see how he looked at it when Abel brought his best. Okay, go ahead.
And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect.
So now, if you bring some little tow-up little lamb to sacrifice for the Lord, he don't want that lamb. Book can tell you, say, give it to your governor, see if he'll accept it, right? So why are you going to bring it to the Lord if you won't bring it to nobody else? So he said, for Cain, he did not accept it. Okay, go ahead.
And Cain was very wrong, and his countenance fell.
Now, that's typical Israel, ain't it? Why you don't want to accept what I got? Why you don't take what I got? Bring your best. Then it's more acceptable to the Lord. Okay, go ahead.
And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted?
Now, all you got to do is do well. Then you will be accepted. So this thing started way back before the children of Israel came out of Egypt. They brought an offer to the Lord. They showed the Lord they was doing okay. They brought forth their best. And the Lord said, you're doing good. But if you bring forth for your worst, he ain't going to accept that. But he give you opportunity to do it better. That's all Cain had to do. Start over, bring the first fruit. Okay, go ahead.
And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him.
So if you don't do well, guess what? You're going to go down. And you're going to have trouble. And it's going to rule over you. If we got people in trouble right now. Because they thinking their finances ain't this and their financing ain't that. Put your trust in the Lord, and he will bless you. Okay, and we're going to show you that throughout the scriptures. But now, let's go to Proverbs, the third chapter. Proverbs 3, and we're going to pick it up at verse 9. Proverbs 3, and verse 9. Go ahead.
honor the Lord with thy substance, mm-hmm. and with the first fruits of all thine increase. Mm-hmm. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty, mm-hmm. and thy presses shall burst out with new wine.
Now, ain't that something? He said, honor me with your substance, with the first fruits of your increase, and he will bless you. That's scripture. And the word of the Lord, he cannot lie, can he?
Nope.
So you have to follow what he say, right? Now, let's go to Psalm the 50th chapter. Psalm 50. And we're going to pick it up at verse 7. Go ahead.
Hear, O my people, mm-hmm. and I will speak, uh-huh. O Israel, and I will testify against thee. Mm-hmm. I am God, even thy God.
So now you know who's talking, right? Okay, go ahead.
I will not reprove thee for thy sacrifices, mm-hmm. or thy burnt offering, mm-hmm. to have been continually before me.
Uh-huh.
I will take no bullock out of thy house, mm-hmm. nor he-goats out of thy fold.
Uh-huh.
For every beast of the forest is mine, uh-huh. and the cattle upon a thousand hills.
Now you think you're going to sacrifice something to me? It's his already. Don't you know the Lord can kill your whole herd in one night? Mm. And bottom line is, he said, I don't need you to offer it to me because they mine anyway. And he said he got cattle on a thousand hills. Okay, go ahead.
I know all the fowls of the mountain, mm-hmm. and the wild beasts of the field are mine. Mm-hmm. If I were hungry, mm-hmm. I would not tell thee.
Ain't that something? What do he need from you? Hmm. I'm gonna go out here and kill me a big animal for the Lord. You can't feed him. Hmm. It's his animal. Okay, go ahead.
For the world is mine, mm-hmm. and the fullness thereof.
Uh-huh.
Will I eat the flesh of bulls, mm-hmm. or drink the blood of goats?
Uh-huh.
Offer unto God thanksgiving, mm-hmm. and pay thy vows unto the Most High.
Ain't that something? Because we're going to look at this in a little detail, because sometimes people make vows and say, I'm going to pay this, I'm going to do that, I'm going to do that, then they don't do nothing. Mm. And they think it's a slight thing because they think it's always got to be about money. But no, sometimes you can vow to your service, and then you don't do it, that's a break of a promise. That's a break of a vow. So if you're going to say you're going to do something, do it. And do it with thanksgiving, didn't he say? Because mm-hmm. be thankful about it. Okay, but go ahead.
And call upon me in the day of trouble.
Uh-huh.
I will deliver thee, mm-hmm. and thou shalt glorify me.
Because then you're going to be saying, thank God. Because he helped me out of my situation. Because we all going to have situations. Because mm-hmm. we in Caesar's world, we can't control everything. Nope. We might think we can, but you can't. But when the time comes, guess where you can go? To the storehouse. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Isaiah 66 chapter. Isaiah 66. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Isaiah 66. And verse 1. Go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord,
mm-hmm.
the heaven is my throne,
mm-hmm.
and the earth is my footstool.
Mm-hmm.
Where is the house that ye build unto me?
Uh-huh.
And where is the place of my rest?
Uh-huh.
For all those things have mine hand made.
Now, he said, you're going to build me a house, but I made this. You couldn't put a stick in the wall if he didn't have a tree grow out the ground, could you? Mm. So he said, he made all these things. Okay, go ahead.
And all those things have been, mm-hmm. saith the Lord.
Uh-huh.
But to this man will I look,
uh-huh.
even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit,
mm-hmm.
and trembleth at my word.
So who is he going to look to? To you, to take care of. Because he could come down and take care of everything, but he wants you to do it, and he wants you to do it with the right spirit and the right heart and right mind. Because you're going to take care of the Lord's business. You can't be no evil person. You can't be no cussing people out, this, that, and the other. You got to represent the Lord in a good way. And sometimes it's financial, sometimes it's spiritual, and sometimes it's just comforting. Just that simple, okay? But now, let's go to Matthew, the 17th chapter. Matthew 17, I just want to show you, just like I said in the beginning, how the Lord don't need you to take care of him, but he looked to man to show him how you respect him, okay? Matthew 17 and verse 24. Go ahead.
And when they were come to Capernaum,
mm-hmm.
they that received tribute money came to Peter and said,
mm-hmm.
doth not your master pay tribute?
Now, who's the master? He's talking about Jesus. Okay, go ahead.
He said, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And when he was come into the house, Jesus prevented him, saying,
mm-hmm.
what thinkest thou, Simon?
Mm-hmm.
Of whom do the kings of the earth take custom or tribute?
Mm-hmm.
Of their own children or of strangers?
Uh-huh.
Peter saith unto him, of strangers. Mm-hmm. Jesus saith unto him, mm-hmm. that are the children free?
Go ahead.
Notwithstanding, mm-hmm. lest we should offend them, mm-hmm. go thou to the sea and cast an hook.
Mm-hmm. Now, you say cast in what? Uh-huh. A hook. You say get no bait or nothing, so I don't know if Peter knew that because Peter was a fisherman anyway. Mm-hmm. But he said cast in a hook. Go ahead.
And take up the fish that first cometh up. Mm-hmm. And when thou hast opened his mouth, mm-hmm. thou shalt find a piece of money. Uh-huh. That take, mm-hmm. and give unto them for me and thee.
Ain't that something? Jesus had Judas walk around with the purse, right? Or with the money bag, right? But did he need it? No, he just did it so he wouldn't offend while he was doing his ministry, because they had to pay tribute in certain areas, right? So the bottom line is, sometimes it takes money to make sure you can get to presenting the word of God. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Leviticus, the 27th chapter. Genesis 14. Because, like I say, people say, well, how much do we supposed to pay, Brother Marlon? Well, let's find out. Let's go by what the scriptures say, because you got some people say, well, I pay this, I pay that, I pay it my will, or, you know, this, that, and the other. The Lord put a set amount on it. Genesis 14 and verse 14. Go ahead.
And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, mm-hmm. he armed his trained servants, mm-hmm. born in his own house, 318, mm-hmm. and pursued them unto Dan.
Now, Lot wasn't his brother. Lot was his nephew.
Right.
But they just said brother in this section here. But that's not a problem. We can deal with that later. Okay, go ahead.
And he divided himself against them, mm-hmm. he and his servants, by night, mm-hmm. and smote them, and pursued them unto Hobah, mm-hmm. which is on the left hand of Damascus. Mm-hmm. And he brought back all the goods, and also brought again his brother Lot, mm-hmm. and his goods, mm-hmm. and the women also, and the people.
So now, when Abraham went out to fight, he fought. And he brought back everything these guys took. They would have been okay, except for they took Lot. And that's when Abraham got involved. Okay, but go ahead.
And the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter of Shador Laomer, mm-hmm. and of the kings that were with him, mm-hmm. at the valley of Sheba, which is the king's dale. Mm-hmm. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, mm-hmm. brought forth bread and wine. Mm-hmm. And he was the priest of the Most High God.
Now, who is Melchizedek? Gee, that's another lesson, but we can deal with that later. But he brought... Melchizedek means king of Salem, right? King of peace. Okay, but go ahead.
And he blessed him, mm-hmm. and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God, mm-hmm. possessor of heaven and earth, uh-huh. and blessed be the Most High God, mm-hmm. which have delivered thine enemies into thy hand. Uh-huh. And he gave him tithes of all.
Now he gave him what? Tithes of all. What does tithes mean? Tenth.
That's right.
So he gave him a tenth of all his earnings that he brought back. Okay, now let's go to Genesis the 28th chapter. Genesis 28 to show you that it passed down from generation to generation all the way down to Jacob. And Jacob understood what his grandfather did, because Abraham was his grandfather, okay? Genesis 28, and we're going to pick it up at verse 10. Go ahead.
And Jacob went out from Beersheba, mm-hmm. and went toward Haran, uh-huh. and he lighted up a certain place, mm-hmm. and tarried there all night, mm-hmm. because the sun was set.
Because he was running from his brother Esau. That's why he was taking off, okay? But go ahead.
And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows, and lay down in that place to sleep. Mm-hmm. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, mm-hmm. and the top of it reached to heaven. Mm-hmm. And behold, the angels of God ascended and descended on it. Mm-hmm. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, uh-huh. I am the Lord God of Abraham, thy father, mm-hmm. and the God of Isaac. The land whereon thou liest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. Mm-hmm. And thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the west, and to the east, mm-hmm. and to the north, and to the south. Uh-huh. And in thee and in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Mm-hmm. And behold, I am with thee, and will keep thee in all places whither thou goest, mm-hmm. and will bring thee again into this land. Uh-huh. For I will not leave thee until I have done that which I have spoken to thee of.
So now he let them know, I'm with you, and I'm going to keep the promise with you that I had with your father and your grandfather. Okay, but go ahead. Let's skip down to verse 20.
And Jacob vowed a vow, mm-hmm. saying, if God will be with me, mm-hmm. I will keep me in and will keep me in this way that I go, uh-huh. and will give me bread to eat, mm-hmm. and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, mm-hmm. then shall the Lord be my God. Uh-huh. And this stone, which I have set for a pillar, shall be God's house. Mm-hmm. And of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth unto thee.
Now, what's a tithe? A tenth. And he promised you that. But did he ask for riches and gain? No. He just asked for food and raiment and housing, right? Mm-hmm. He said, that's all I need. And that's all we all need. Sometimes the Lord bless others with a lot more, and sometimes others, you know, the Lord bless you with a tenth. But whatever he bless you with, that's what you got coming. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Matthew, the 22nd chapter. Matthew 22. Because I know it's hard, especially, you know, for black men in America, to get a job and keep a job is rough. But the Lord still expects you to give him his portion, whatever you make. And you got to do it, you got to be accepted in a certain way, because the Lord don't just take anything from anybody. You know, I ain't had that in the scripture, but I'm going to read it anyway. But after we read this, okay? Matthew 22 and verse 15. Go ahead.
Then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk.
Mm-hmm.
And they sent out unto him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know that thou art true and teachest the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of man.
Now, understand, they come in here respectfully, but they trying to trick him up. That's how Satan operate. That's how you know some preachers call themselves humble, but they ain't humble. They just trying to be sneaky. But the Lord knew how they operate. Okay, go ahead.
Tell us, therefore, what thinkest thou? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? But Jesus perceived their wickedness and said, why tempt ye me, ye hypocrites?
What do you call it? Hypocrites. Come to him all nice and sweet and everything, but then you know what they doing. Okay, go ahead.
Show me the tribute money. And they brought unto him a penny. And he saith unto them, who is this image and superscription? They say unto him, Caesar's. Then said he unto them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar, and unto God the things that are God.
Get that something? You got to pay taxes. You pay your taxes, but what you owe to the Lord, you give to the Lord. You got to pay your utility. Pay your utility. But what you got to give to the Lord is his tenth. That's why he said, give Caesar what is Caesar's, but give unto God what is God. Okay, go ahead.
When they had heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way.
Ain't that something? Shut him up. Because you don't know. He's going against the master. But he let them know, I don't care what your situation is, pay your tribute wherever you are, but take care of the Lord's business. Okay? Now, let's go to Deuteronomy 23rd chapter. I'm going to show you something real quick. Deuteronomy 23. And we're just going to pick up some things here while we're on our way here, you know. Just to show you how what the Lord expects you to bring to him, okay? Deuteronomy 23, and we'll pick it up at verse 17. A lot of people don't know this, but it's in the book, so you got to read it sometime. Deuteronomy 23 and 17. Go ahead.
There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel.
Now, the Lord don't want the women to be harlots, and he don't want the men to be what? Gay.
Yeah, that's right.
We read the book, right?
Yep.
Okay, go ahead.
Thou shalt not bring the hire of a whore or the price of a dog into the house of the Lord thy God for any value.
He don't want their money. So, because bottom line is, if you're dirty, you're dirty, and the Lord don't want that. So he picky too, right? Yes, you can't say, I'm about here, I made this money, I pimped these women, I'm going to bring a tenth to the church. That don't work. The Lord don't want the price of a whore or a hire of a dog, which means a male whore. Plain and simple. Okay, but go ahead.
For even both these are abomination unto the Lord thy God.
Ain't that something? He's going to talk about a little bit more money, so let's read a little bit more, just since we're here. Okay, go ahead.
Thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother. Usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury.
Now, until your own people, you ain't supposed to lend money, so you got to give me back double. When you trying to you help somebody out, you just give it to them, and you don't charge them no interest. That's why sometimes people get in a situation, I said they want to borrow somebody. I said, you can borrow somebody from church, no problem. Just make sure, you know, you pay it back if you're going to borrow it. You know? But we ain't going to charge you no interest. The Lord said you pay interest when when you borrow from your tithes. That's when you pay interest. Okay? We're going to read that too. Okay? But go ahead.
Unto a stranger thou mayest lend upon usury. But unto thy brother thou shalt not lend upon usury. That the Lord thy God may bless thee in all that thou settest thine hand to end the land whither thou goest to possess it.
Go ahead.
When thou shalt vow a vow unto the Lord thy God, mm-hmm. thou shalt not slack to pay it.
Uh-huh.
For the Lord thy God will surely require it of thee,
mm-hmm.
and it will be sin in thee.
So now don't say you're going to do something, or even say you're going to offer a free will offering, or make a vow to do anything for the Lord, and don't do it. And then, like I said, if you lend money, you ain't supposed to charge no usury. Only to the stranger can you start usury. But you know, Israel, that curse is on us. We borrowed, we ain't lending. Right? So we ain't got to worry about that part. That's scripted at all. So the bottom line, I just took y'all there to see what things the Lord accepted, what he don't accept, and what you better do if you open up your mouth and say you're going to do something, don't do it. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to, now I jumped off the table a little bit there, but now let's go to Leviticus, the 27th chapter. Leviticus 27. And we're going to pick it up at verse 30. Because like I said, when people start talking about, you know, the type of tithes you're supposed to bring to the Lord, you know, these guys just not paying attention to what the scripture's saying. Like I say, especially in our society right now, it operates on money. I ain't got no cornfield I can bring something to a utility company and say, look, I need you to cut my phone back on. I got a bale of hay in the back. Come on. It don't work that way, okay? Leviticus 27 and verse 30. Go ahead.
And all the tithe of the land,
mm-hmm.
whether of the seed of the land
mm-hmm.
or of the fruit of the tree,
mm-hmm.
is the Lord.
Uh-huh.
It is holy unto the Lord.
So now that tithe is what? It's holy unto the Lord. Okay, go ahead.
And if a man would all redeem all of his tithe,
mm-hmm.
he shall add thereto the fifth part thereof.
So now if you say, well, look, I can't pay my tithe this week, the portion I was supposed to give to the Lord, you got to pay a fifth part of that. What is that, 20%? That's some high interest, but that's the Lord charge you because you're using his money. Mm-hmm. Pay it and have faith in the Lord and he'll take care of you. And I'll show you that. I'm going to show you that in the scriptures today. So you shouldn't have to worry about that. But the bottom line is just take care of the Lord's business when you first get it. Not off your net, off your gross. I had to learn that. Because the bottom line is whatever you get, that's what you got to pay a tenth off of. Ain't the Lord's fault you getting garnished. Ain't the Lord's fault that you got to pay insurance. Ain't the Lord's fault you got a 401k. You pay off the top. Just that simple. Okay, go ahead.
And concerning the tithe of the herd,
mm-hmm.
or of the flock,
mm-hmm.
even of whatsoever passes under the rod,
uh-huh.
the tenth shall be holy unto the Lord.
So now if you bring your whole herd, you say, I will give a tenth to the Lord. You just bring that herd, and the priest will just pick out a tenth up. Okay, go ahead.
He shall not search whether it be good or bad,
uh-huh.
neither shall he change it.
Mm-hmm.
And if he change it at all,
mm-hmm.
then both it and the change thereof shall be holy,
mm-hmm.
and it shall not be redeemed.
So now if he change, he'll say, look, you know what, that wouldn't look bad. I don't want to give him. I want to give a better one. Then the Lord accept it. Mm-hmm. But if you take a good one and take it and turn it into the bad one, then you know the Lord don't like that, right? So you know if he change it, it better be for the better and not the worse. Okay, but go ahead.
These are the commandments
mm-hmm.
which the Lord commanded Moses mm-hmm. for the children of Israel mm-hmm. in Mount Sinai.
Ain't that something? Just let you know how to bring him an offering. Plain and simple. Okay, now, let's go to Luke the 6th chapter. Luke 6. And we're going to pick it up. We're just going to read one verse here, verse 38. Go ahead.
Give,
mm-hmm.
and it shall be given unto you.
Uh-huh.
Good measure,
mm-hmm.
pressed down, and shaken together,
mm-hmm.
and running over,
uh-huh.
shall men give into your bosom.
Mm-hmm.
For with the same measure that you meet withal,
mm-hmm.
it shall be measured to you again.
So now, if you give a little, what you got coming? A little. Mm-hmm. But you give a lot, you got a lot coming back.
That's right.
The Lord said, but if you give, he's going to have it so much pressure, you're going to be turning over. You're going to be walking down the street and find a $100 bill on the ground. All of a sudden, you're going to go check your bank account. All of a sudden, you thought you was negative, and all of a sudden, it's got $2,000 in there. It can happen. Believe me. So the bottom line is, have faith in the Lord, and he will take care of you.
That's right.
Don't give it grudgingly, and like I say, he will take care of you. Okay, now, let's go to 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. 2 Corinthians 9. And believe me, I put this lesson off for like 4 or 5 weeks. Because during that time frame, you know, we helping people out, this, that, the other. I didn't want them to think that I turned right back around and started that. I want my money back. I didn't want it to happen that way. So I kept putting it off, but I couldn't put it off anymore because that's the job we in. It's taking care of the people. So it was going to always be continuous that we helping people. And we helping people of this church and sometimes other people as well. Because if it's a part of this membership and they need to help somebody and they think they got to do it, we help them whatever they got to do. Except for certain situations. There's a limit on everything. A limit on everything. Okay, but now, 1 Corinthians 9, and we're going to pick it up at verse 6. Go ahead.
But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. Mm-hmm. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully.
Now that ties in what we just read, right? You sow a little, you get a little. You sow a lot, you get a lot. Okay, go ahead.
Every man according as he purposeth in his heart. Uh-huh. So let him give, not grudgingly.
You can't give it grudgingly now. But whatever it proposes in your heart, that's what the Lord going to be looking at. Okay, go ahead.
Or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Uh-huh. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work.
Ain't that something? Because, you know, my family think I'm a walking ATM machine. Right? But that's because the Lord blessed me that they know if they get into a situation, who can they call? Bless me. Man. And I don't always help them now because I got a limitation on them too. Because you always got to have a limitation, but the bottom line is you help people out when you can. Because they know you've been blessed. I got family members, got churches, you hear me? And they suffer every Sunday and then they calling me Monday. Wait a minute now. Why are you calling me? And I tell them specifically, look, I'll help you, but I ain't doing a nickel for that church. Now, if you need some money, I got you. But that church, I ain't giving a quarter. And they know that. So when they come after me for money, I'm saying, what is it for? You hear me? There ain't like no loan application or like that. I just got to know where my money going. Because I ain't finna help the devil at all. Plain and simple. Okay, but go ahead.
As it is written, he hath dispersed abroad. Uh-huh. He hath given to the poor. Mm-hmm. His righteousness remaineth forever.
Ain't that something? So you can give and don't give grudgingly. Give with a good heart and know that this is for the Lord's business. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Numbers, the 18th chapter. Numbers 18. Because sometimes people can be despaired because they think something going on in the church, and sometimes, you know, you find some people doing things contrary to the word of God, and you say, well, I ain't gonna support that church no more. And the churches fall because of that. But then when you see somebody doing something right, that's when you should support that church. And if you learn it from that church, or you learn in the word of God, you should be supporting that church. If you're not, you're a hypocrite. Yeah. Because you're just reaping the rewards from the word of God and ain't getting nothing, putting nothing in it. And that is a hypocrite. Okay, but now, Numbers 18 and verse 20. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Aaron, thou shalt have no inheritance in their land, neither shalt thou have any part among them. I am thy part and thine inheritance among the children of Israel.
So now, the priest couldn't have no land because the Lord was their inheritance. But the people had to take care of the priest. Okay, go ahead.
And behold, I have given the children of Levi all the tenth in Israel for an inheritance.
So now, what did he give the Israelite, the priest? The tenth of the tithe that the people gave them took care of the priest. Okay, go ahead.
For their service which they served, even the service of the tabernacle of the congregation.
Now, that means every Levite that was doing service for the tabernacle got paid. Don't you know some Levites only sung? Zechariah, what was his job? To light the candle in the temple, right? That was his one job, just light the candle. And he got paid for that, right? Because the people paid a tenth and took care of the Levite priest. Okay, but go ahead.
Neither must the children of Israel henceforth come nigh the tabernacle of the congregation, lest they bear sin and die.
Ain't that something? Because whose job is it now? The priest.
That's right.
And the children of Israel don't need to work it no more because the priest going to take care of it. You just take care of the priest. Okay, go ahead.
But the Levites shall do the service of the tabernacle of the congregation, and they shall bear their iniquity. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generation that among the children of Israel they have no inheritance. But the tithes of the children of Israel, which they offer as an heave offering unto the Lord, I have given to the Levites to inherit. Therefore I have said unto them, among the children of Israel, they shall have no inheritance.
So now, who take care of the priests? The people. But the bottom line is, the Leviticus priesthood ain't in effect no more, but we're going to show you that it was changed and how you still will take care of the Lord's church. Okay, but go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, thus speak unto the Levites, and say unto them, when ye take of the children of Israel the tithes which I have given you from them for your inheritance, then ye shall offer up an heave offering of it for the Lord, even a tenth part of the tithe.
Now the priest got to pay a tenth. So everybody got to pay a tenth. So ain't nobody getting around it. You got to pay a tenth of whatever you get from the Lord or from the people. Whatever your increase is, that's what you pay a tenth part of. Okay, but go ahead.
And this your heave offering shall be reckoned unto you as though it were the corn of the threshing floor and as the fullness of the wine press. Thus ye also shall offer an heave offering unto the Lord of all your tithes, which ye receive of the children of Israel. And ye shall give thereof the Lord's heave offering to Aaron the priest.
So now the Levites had to give it to the high priest. So everybody had to pay tithe because of their increase. Nobody gets around it. Everybody got to participate, okay? But now, let's go to Hebrews, the 7th chapter. Hebrews 7, and we're going to pick it up at verse 5. Hebrews 7 and verse 5. Go ahead.
And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law. That is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham.
Now he just threw a wrinkle in there. He said, but he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham. Who was that? Melchizedek. Right? And what seed did Jesus come through? The seed of Judah.
That's right.
So we're going to find out that now it ain't under the Levitical priesthood. Now it's under the Melchizedek priesthood. Okay, go ahead.
And blessed him that had the promise. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. And here men that die receive tithes. But there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. And as I may say, so say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abraham.
And that's what we just read. Okay, go ahead.
For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him.
Now, Levi paid tithes, but his father Abraham paid tithes to who? Melchizedek. Okay, go ahead.
If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron?
Go ahead.
For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law.
Go ahead.
For he of whom these things are spoken pertaining to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar.
Was Judah at the altar?
No, sir.
No, sir. So the bottom line is, it changed from Levi back to Melchizedek, which is Jesus. Okay, but go ahead.
For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest.
So now who's that other priest? Jesus.
That's right.
So that's who you're making your offering to today. That's who you're paying your tithe to today. Not the Levitical priesthood, but to the Lord. Okay, now skip down to verse 21. What, did you finish 17?
No.
Go ahead.
Who was made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. For he testified, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek.
So now you know it's been changed, okay? Because he said that specifically, that it's been changed, okay? Skip down to verse 21.
For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continued forever, hath an unchangeable priesthood.
Now, was he in effect before Levi was in effect? Yes. But he gave it to Levi for a little while until he came, died for the sins of man, and it went back into his hand. So it's back to where it was from the beginning. Okay, go ahead.
Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them.
Go ahead.
For such an high priest became us, who was holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens.
Go ahead.
Who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sin, and then for the people's. For this he did once, when he offered up himself.
Now, we know who that was, right?
Jesus.
Okay, go ahead.
For the law maketh man high priest, which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who was consecrated forevermore.
Now, if he consecrated forevermore, who we pay our tithes to? The Lord. And when he returned, he's going to accept the Levitical priesthood again, but you still going to be bringing to him because he's going to be there. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Luke, the 8th chapter. I had to take you there because, like I say, most people, they don't believe in Jesus anyway. But now, if you don't acknowledge him, then you're going to have a problem. Because all your offerings are going to be for nothing. And that's why, like we say, when this sister call around to see these other camps and they ain't get the phone numbers disconnected, because they teaching that you ain't got to pay no tithe. That's why your phone bill ain't paid. And that's why your storehouse is shut down. Just that simple, okay? Luke 8 and verse 1. Go ahead.
And it came to pass afterward that he went throughout every city and village, preaching and showing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God. And the 12 were with him. And certain women, which had been healed of evil spirits and infirmity, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom went 7 devils, and Joanna, the wife of Chuzza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others, which ministered unto him of their substance.
Of their what?
Substance.
So who they giving their substance to? Jesus. Because they know this thing is changing, and they got to support him because he's the one preaching about the kingdom of God. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to Matthew, the 2nd chapter. Matthew 2. Just want to show you something here, because sometimes I'll just be sitting on the phone, we don't talk, brothers be talking. And they say something. I said, man, you know I'm finna use that, right? And this is something, you know, we all read this, but I ain't never paid no attention to it. Like I said, we sitting around, we talking, okay? Matthew 2 and verse 1. Go ahead.
Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem.
Now these wise men came because they were looking for the king of the Jews, right? And when they found him, let's see what they brought to him. Go skip down to verse 11.
And when they were come into the house.
They were coming to what?
The house.
Not outside in a barn in a manger, right? They came in the house. Okay, go ahead.
They saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold.
Wait a minute. Go, not meat. Not no fruit or no corn. They gave him what? Money. Go. Okay, go ahead.
And frankincense and myrrh.
Now, that would pay for a college fund, wouldn't it? So they brought him gold and other things, but they brought money. As a baby. You hear me? So you know, like I say, the Lord know where his money is. He don't can get it any time because the whole world is his anyway. Him and the Father. Okay, but now, I just had to point that out to y'all. Now, let's go to Exodus the 30th chapter. Exodus 30, because then the question will come up, well, who's supposed to pay tithes? So we're going to look at this right now because it's the same thing applies to baptism. Because when you go into a covenant with the Lord, you have to be of age. So we're going to look and see if what the age thing where the Lord showed where you have age responsibility. And if you have age responsibility, that means you cannot baptize a child. And you definitely can't baptize a baby that can't talk, walk, speak, or nothing. Right? Because they don't know what they're going into, so that thing is a whole farce. Just that simple. Okay? But now, Exodus 30, and we're going to pick it up at verse 11. Exodus 30 and verse 11. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, when thou takest the sum of the children of Israel after their number, then shall they give every man a ransom for his soul unto the Lord when thou numberest them, that there be no plague among them when thou numberest them.
So now the Lord expects you to pay a certain tribute to him when you be counted as one of his people. Okay, but go ahead.
This they shall give. Everyone that passeth among them that are numbered, half a shekel after the shekel of the sanctuary. A shekel is 20 gerahs.
Now, I don't know what that is. I just know it's a weight. So whatever you had to bring, it had to weigh a certain amount for the Lord to accept. Okay, go ahead.
And half shekel shall be the offering of the Lord. Everyone that passeth among them that are numbered, from 20 years old and above, shall give an offering unto the Lord.
Now, what age did he establish it at? 20 years old. So when the Lord expects you to be responsible, you should be at least 20 years old. Not 40, not 50, 20. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's look at it again. Did you finish that? Now, let's go to Numbers, the 14th chapter. Numbers 14. And we're going to pick it up at verse 26. Numbers 14 and verse 26. This is when the children of Israel was in the wilderness, and they was getting ready to go into the land. They spied the land, but some guys came back with an evil report saying, look, we can't go over there and take the land. So the Lord's gonna put a separation on them between them and their children. And we're going to see what age he started that separation with. Okay? Numbers 14 and verse 26. Go ahead.
And the Lord spake unto Moses and unto Aaron, saying, how long shall I bear with this evil congregation which murmur against me? I have heard the murmurs of the children of Israel which they murmur against me.
Now, mind you now, the Lord had just brought them out of Egypt, did all those wonderful works in Egypt, those miracles, killed the firstborn in Egypt, split the Red Sea, and they still over here murmur at all that. Okay, but go ahead.
Say unto them, as truly as I live, saith the Lord, as ye have spoken in mine ears, so will I do to you. Your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness, and all that were numbered of you, according to your whole number, from 20 years old and upward, which have murmured against me, doubtless ye shall not come into the land, concerning which I swear to make you dwell therein, save Caleb the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua the son of Nun.
So now, what age did he separate them at?
20
years old. Because they murmured against him. And like I say, the Lord just got fed up right here. I'm done. Now y'all carcass is going to die in the wood. Okay, go ahead.
But your little one, which he said should be a prey, them will I bring in, and they shall know the land which ye have despised.
Ain't that something? So all y'all going to die. Could you imagine standing there and hearing them say that? Saying, you above 20, you gone. Your day is on the clock. Just that simple. Okay, now. Let's go to, because they knew it was going to be 40 years, so they knew they were going to die in a short time. Now, let's go to 2 Chronicles, the 24th chapter. 2 Chronicles 24, and we're going to pick it up at verse 4. 2 Chronicles 24 and verse 4. Go ahead.
And it came to pass after this that Joash was minded to repair the house of the Lord.
Now, because some people, you know, they just took over the house of the Lord, and they was bringing all paganism, they was doing false worship. So the people stopped paying tithe. People stopped taking care of it. So this guy wanted to repair the house of the Lord, get it back to where it's supposed to be. Okay, but go ahead.
And he gathered together the priests and the Levites and said to them, go out unto the cities of Judah and gather of all Israel money to repair the house of your God from year to year.
Now, did he say gather corn and wheat?
No, money.
They get some money, man. Because we got to take care of the house of the Lord. Okay, but go ahead.
And see that ye hasten the matter. Howbeit the Levites hasten not. And the king called for Jehoiada the chief and said unto him, why hast thou not required of the Levites to bring in out of Judah and out of Jerusalem the collection according to the commandment of Moses, the servant of the Lord?
According to who? The commandment of Moses, the servant of the Lord. Where did Moses get the commandment from? From the Lord.
That's right.
So he said, tell the people to bring the money to take care of the Lord's house as commanded by God. Just that simple, OK? Okay, but go ahead.
And of the congregation of Israel, mm-hmm. for the tabernacle of witness.
Uh-huh.
For the sons of Athaliah, the wicked woman, that mm-hmm. wicked woman, mm-hmm. had broken up the house of God.
Uh-huh.
And also all the dedicated things of the house of the Lord mm-hmm. that they bestow upon Baalim.
So now, because they started doing all this wickedness, the people backed off of it. Because I ain't going to put my money in no paganism. So that's why they stopped doing it. Okay, but go ahead.
And at the king's commandment, they made a chest
mm-hmm.
and set it without at the gate of the house of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And they made a proclamation through Judah and Jerusalem to bring in to the Lord mm-hmm. the collection that Moses, the servant of God, laid upon Israel in the wilderness.
Now, he said that because this ain't for Balaam no more. And this ain't for Attila. This is for the Lord. Okay, go ahead.
And all the princes and all the people rejoiced
mm-hmm.
and brought in
mm-hmm.
and cast into the chest
mm-hmm.
until they had made an end.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it came to pass that at what time the chest was brought unto the king's office by the hand of the Levites,
mm-hmm.
and when they saw that there was much money.
What? Much money? According to the commandment of the Lord. Go ahead.
The king's scribe and the high priest officer came and emptied the chest
mm-hmm.
and took it and carried it to his place again.
Mm-hmm.
Thus they did day by day
uh-huh.
and gathered money in abundance.
What? Gathered what? In abundance? I'm still waiting for that chest over there to get full, but I know that day coming. But the chest is over there. Y'all ain't see nobody pass no plate or nothing, right?
That's right. That's
and
right.
you will never see nobody pass no plate. It's on you to put the money in the chest. Because the people rejoiced and they brought the money day by day to take care of the Lord's house. Okay, go ahead.
And the king and Jehoiada gave it to such as did the work of the service of the house of the Lord,
mm-hmm.
and hired masons and carpenters mm-hmm. to repair the house of the Lord,
mm-hmm.
and also such as wrought iron and brass mm-hmm. to mend the house of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
So the workmen wrought, and the work was perfected by mm-hmm. them.
Uh-huh.
And they set the house of God in his state mm-hmm. and strengthened it.
So sometimes you might drive by here and you see some guys working on the house. We got them doing that. Why? Because we got the money to take care of the Lord's house. Our last project, which we got, well, this is the last project since we bought this place, is to replace those windows and doors right there. And that's happening next week. Because we got money in the storehouse to take care of. Just that simple. Okay, but go ahead.
And when they had finished it,
mm-hmm.
they brought the rest of the money before the king mm-hmm. and Jehoiada,
uh-huh.
where were made vessels for the house of the Lord,
mm-hmm.
even vessels to minister,
mm-hmm.
and to offer withal,
uh-huh.
and spoons, and vessels of gold and silver.
Uh-huh.
And they offered burnt offerings in the house of the Lord
mm-hmm.
continually mm-hmm. all the days of Jehoiada.
Ain't that something? Because this man was in the right mind to take care of the Lord's house. The people wanted to be in with him. They did it, and they brought it in. Because no, ain't nobody gonna support no paganism. You shouldn't. And you should rejoice in it. But that's what we just had, just this December 25th. But that's another lesson. But the bottom line is, when you know the thing is right and it's according to the Lord's will, and you know it's good and it's according to Scripture, you should support it. Just that simple. Okay. Now, let's go to Haggai the first chapter. No, Haggai. I mean, Second Chronicles 31. Second Chronicles 31. And we're gonna pick it up at verse 1, 2 Chronicles 31, and verse 1. Go ahead.
Now when all this was finished,
mm-hmm.
all Israel that were present went out to the cities of Judah
mm-hmm.
and break the images in pieces
mm-hmm.
and cut down the grove
mm-hmm.
and threw down the high places and the altars mm-hmm. out of all Judah mm-hmm. and Benjamin
mm-hmm.
and Ephraim also and Manasseh
mm-hmm.
until they had utterly destroyed them all.
Uh-huh.
Then all the children of Israel returned,
mm-hmm.
every man to his possession into their own city.
Uh-huh.
And Hezekiah appointed the courses of the priests and the Levites after their courses,
mm-hmm.
every man according to his service,
mm-hmm.
the priests and the Levites for burnt offerings
mm-hmm.
and for peace offerings, to minister and to give thanks and to praise in the gates of the tents of the Lord.
So now a second time they had to go in and repair the house of the Lord and get all the paganism out of it again and correct everything, and now Hezekiah is doing this. Okay, go ahead.
He appointed also the king's portion of his substance
mm-hmm.
for the burnt offerings,
mm-hmm.
to wit, for the morning and evening burnt offerings
mm-hmm.
and the burnt offerings for the Sabbath
mm-hmm.
and for the new moon
mm-hmm.
and for the set feasts
mm-hmm.
as it is written in the law of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
Moreover, he commanded the people that dwelt in Jerusalem
mm-hmm.
to give the portion of the priests and the Levites
mm-hmm.
that they might be encouraged in the law of the Lord.
Now, if the priests starving, you think they gonna come to work?
No, sir.
If you ain't taking care of the priests, they ain't gonna be encouraged or strengthened to do nothing, right? So you have to take care of them in order to keep them strong. Okay, but go ahead.
And as soon as the commandment came abroad, mm-hmm. the children of Israel brought in abundance the first fruits of corn, mm-hmm. wine, mm-hmm. and oil, and honey, mm-hmm. and of all the increase of the field, uh-huh. and the tithe of all things brought they in abundance.
Now, what's the tithe of all things? We don't know, right? But it could be money as well, right?
That's right.
So it includes everything that they brought to take care of the priest, so the priest can take care of the teaching the law, so they can take care of the house of the Lord. Everything has to be taken care of, and it costs money. Just that simple. Okay, go ahead.
And concerning the children of Israel, mm-hmm. and Judah, mm-hmm. that dwelt in the cities of Judah, mm-hmm. they also brought in the tithe of oxen and sheep, mm-hmm. and the tithe of holy things which were consecrated unto the Lord their God, uh-huh. and laid them by heaps.
Now they got it in heaps. Because the people wanted to give and take care of the Lord's business, that they got store of it now. Not just a little, they got a lot. Okay, but go ahead.
In the third month, mm-hmm. they began to lay the foundation of the heap, mm-hmm. and finished them in the seventh month. Mm-hmm. And when Hezekiah and the princes came and saw the heap, mm-hmm. they blessed the Lord and his people Israel.
Ain't that something? Because the king probably was rich enough to do it, but what the Lord say? He wants you to take care of his business. So the people can be taken care of if somebody ever had a need. Okay, but go ahead.
Then Hezekiah questioned with the priests and the Levites concerning the heaps. Uh-huh. And Azariah, the chief priest of the house of Zadok, answered him and said, mm-hmm. since the people began to bring the offerings into the house of the Lord, mm-hmm. we have had enough to eat.
Now the priest can eat now, right? They didn't say they was rich. They just said that we have had enough to eat. Okay, go ahead.
And have left plenty. Mm-hmm. For the Lord have blessed his people, mm-hmm. and that which is left is this great store.
Ain't that something? All the priests took all that stuff home, right? And not leave a heap there at all. But where they leave it? In the storehouse of the Lord's house. Mm-hmm. Just that simple. Okay. Now, let's go to Haggai, the first chapter. Haggai 1. And we're going to pick it up at verse 2. Haggai 1. And verse 2. I'm going to give y'all some time because I know that's one of them hard scriptures to find. You got Malachi, then you got Zechariah, then you got Haggai if you back up from the Old Testament, from the New Testament. So if you have Matthew, you got three books back. Everybody there? Haggai 1. And verse 2. Go ahead.
Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, mm-hmm. this people say, the time is not come, mm-hmm. the time that the Lord's house should be built. Mm-hmm. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, mm-hmm. is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, mm-hmm. and this house lie waste?
Now you take care of your house, but the Lord's house falling apart. And you ain't paying that no attention, but you taking care of your house and putting his second. Okay, go ahead.
Now, therefore, mm-hmm. thus saith the Lord of hosts, mm-hmm. consider your ways. Uh-huh. Ye have sown much, mm-hmm. and bring in little. Uh-huh. Ye eat, mm-hmm. but ye have not enough. Mm-hmm. Ye drink, uh-huh. but ye are not filled with drink. Mm-hmm. Ye clothe you, mm-hmm. but there is none warm. Uh-huh. And he that earneth wages, mm-hmm. earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes.
Now he said, like, you doing all this work, you working hard and everything. You taking care of your business, but you ain't taking care of Lord's business. He said, every time you bring something home, it's like you coming home with a pocket full of money that got holes in it. All of a sudden, you said, what happened to that $100? I thought I just had $100. The Lord took it out your pocket because you ain't taking care of his business. So all that fat money you thought you had, you get home, guess what? Your engine just went down in your car. The roof leaking. Tires done got flat. Yeah. Then you got problem after problem, problem. Please pull you over, write you a $100 ticket. Jeez. You just minding your own business. The Lord cut a hole in your pocket. Because you're putting him second. Mm-hmm. Okay, but go ahead.
Thus saith the Lord of hosts, mm-hmm. consider your ways. Uh-huh. Go up to the mountain, mm-hmm. and bring wood, uh-huh. and build the house. Mm-hmm. And I will take pleasure in it. Uh-huh. And I will be glorified, saith the Lord.
He said, consider your ways. Get back, take care of the Lord's business, and then he'll have pleasure in it. Okay, go ahead.
Ye looked for much, mm-hmm. and lo, it came to little. Mm-hmm. And when ye brought it home, uh-huh. I did blow upon it.
Ain't that something? Because it could come in many ways. You done did overtime. You done worked 4-8 hours. You know you got a big check coming, and all of a sudden taxes hit you. Bam. Or a garnishment pop up from somebody. Well, who I owe money to? All of a sudden your check is nothing. because the Lord blew on it and took it from him. Okay, go ahead.
Why? Mm-hmm. Saith the Lord of hosts. Uh-huh. Because of mine house that is waste. Mm-hmm. And ye run every man unto his own house.
I mean, you taking care of all your stuff, but you ain't taking care of the Lord. And don't think he ain't aware of it. Because you keep saying, oh, I'm gonna, the time is not come. The time is not come. I'm going to get to it. I'm going to get back on track. And the Lord watching your track. And your track keep getting worse and worse and worse. Because you keep putting him off. Okay, go ahead.
Therefore, mm-hmm. the heaven over you is stayed from dew. Uh-huh. And the earth is stayed from her fruit.
So now if you don't get no rain, guess what? You can't grow no crop.
That's right.
Because the Lord can put an extended time on you to go down where it ain't nothing to him. Just that simple. Okay, go ahead.
And I call for a drought mm-hmm. upon the land, uh-huh. and upon the mountains, mm-hmm. and upon the corn, mm-hmm. and upon the new wine, mm-hmm. and upon the oil, mm-hmm. and upon that which the ground bringeth forth, mm-hmm. and upon man, uh-huh. and upon cattle, mm-hmm. and upon all the labor of the hand.
Ain't that something? I see it all the time. When I used to go down in Mississippi, you know, see my grandparents back in the old days, we would drive past the Gentile plantations, and you can see, oh, they got corn everywhere. Get down to our field, it's still this short. Right? There's way up high. Because the Lord can blow on you anytime, any place, if you ain't serving him. I even watch a show called Swamp People. They got one or two black guys that go out there and do the alligator hunting. These Gentiles, they both be full of alligators. This guy barely can catch one. The Lord can blow on your labels all the time. Because you ain't taking care of his business because you're eating alligator too. Which you ain't supposed to be doing. That's why he be blowing on all of them all the time. But that just show you how the Lord can collect from you because you're not taking care of him. Okay? Now, let's go to Luke the 12th chapter. Because sometimes we get ahead of ourselves and we'll say, oh man, I got all this money. Ooh, I don't know what to do. And then you forget about the Lord. That's why David said, Lord, don't give me too much that I forget you, or too little that I sin against you, right? Mm-hmm. Just keep me content, and that's the best way to be, right?
That's right.
Luke 12 and verse 15. Go ahead.
And he said unto them, mm-hmm. take heed and beware of covetousness, mm-hmm. for a man's life consisteth not in the abundance mm-hmm. of the things mm-hmm. which he possesseth.
Ain't that something? You can have a lot, but that ain't what your life is consist of. Mm-hmm. Your life consists of what you give to the Lord. I mean, with your heart and with your possession. Okay, go ahead.
And he spake a parable unto them, saying, mm-hmm. the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. Mm-hmm. And he thought within himself, saying, mm-hmm. what shall I do? Mm-hmm. Because I have no room where to bestow my fruit. Mm-hmm. And he said, this will I do. Mm-hmm. I will pull down my barns mm-hmm. and build greater. Uh-huh. And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods. Mm-hmm. And I will say to my soul, mm-hmm. soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Mm-hmm. Take thine ease, mm-hmm. eat, drink, and be merry. Uh-huh. But God said unto him, thou fool, mm-hmm. this night thy soul shall be required of thee.
What that mean? Yeah. You gonna die tonight. You talking about soul, sit back and rest and have ease. He said, I'm gonna kill you. With all your riches and all your plenty. Okay, go ahead.
Then whose shall those things be mm-hmm. which thou hast provided? Uh-huh. So is he that layeth up treasure for himself mm-hmm. and is not rich toward God.
Ain't that something? How you got to be rich? Toward God. Mm-hmm. How is that rich? With knowledge.
That's right.
That's why the book tell you in Revelations, he said, I know that you are poor, but you are rich. Because you're poor, you know, physically, but rich with knowledge. Okay, but go ahead.
And he said unto his disciples, mm-hmm. therefore I say unto you, mm-hmm. take no thought for your life, mm-hmm. what ye shall eat, mm-hmm. neither for the body, what ye shall put on. Uh-huh. The life is more than meat, mm-hmm. and the body is more than raiment.
Ain't that something? But we can't starve one day. We can't do it. And we got to have our best clothes on, pressed clothes. Like I said, years ago, this store down the street was JB's. That's the name of it?
Yeah.
They got broken into, and they were stealing their $600 jeans. In our neighborhood, who buying $600 pair of jeans?
You'd be surprised.
Exactly, Israel. Back then, ain't nothing changed. Cause back in the day, we was in my neighborhood. You know, we was in a poor neighborhood, but everybody had Cadillacs. The Cadillac cost more than the house, right? But we had to be looking like big shots. I don't know if y'all remember this song. It was like a TV antenna in the back. Diamond in the back, sun rooftop, digging in the wheels with a gangster scene. We wanted to look that way, like we had something, we ain't had nothing, right? I know I'm telling my age now, but that's what it was. That's what we was all about, right? But the bottom line is, the Lord said you all stuck on that instead of taking care of his business and being rich with knowledge. Okay, but go ahead.
24. Uh-huh. Consider the ravens, mm-hmm. for they neither sow nor reap, mm-hmm. which neither have storehouse nor barn, mm-hmm. and God feedeth them.
Don't you know these birds out here, nobody ain't got nobody feeding them? Mm-hmm. They flying all over the place, and the Lord take care of them. They don't plow or sow, and they eat every day. Okay, go ahead.
How much more are ye better than the fowl? Uh-huh. And which of you with taken thought can add to this stature one cubit? Mm-hmm. If ye then be not able to do that thing which is least, mm-hmm. why take ye thought for the rest? Uh-huh. Consider the lilies, how they grow. Mm-hmm. They toil not, they spin not. Mm-hmm. And yet I say unto you that Solomon in all his glory mm-hmm. was not arrayed like one of these.
Now these plants, they grow up and they look better than anybody. They're beautiful, but your clothing, you want to make it look better than that. And Lord say, I can make the plant look better than you dress. So he said, but why are you worried about clothing and food? Okay, go ahead.
If then God so clothed the grass, mm-hmm. which is today in the field, mm-hmm. and tomorrow is cast into the oven, mm-hmm. how much more will he clothe you, mm-hmm. O ye of little faith?
So now we got to stop worrying about that. Sometimes we got to put our faith in the Lord, take care of the Lord's business, and he will take care of you. Just that simple. Okay, but go ahead.
And seek not ye what ye shall eat, mm-hmm. or what ye shall drink, mm-hmm. neither be ye of doubtful mind.
Ain't that something? Because don't you know when the Lord was feeding the people, he was feeding them, and they was with him every day. So when he took away the food, what did Israel do?
Gone.
Walk away. That's why he asked his disciples, y'all going to leave too? But they knew he had the word what? Of eternal life.
That's right.
Right? So they had sense. But the other people, they was just for the food. Plain and simple. Okay, but go ahead.
For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, mm-hmm. and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. Uh-huh. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, mm-hmm. and all these things shall be added unto you.
Ain't that something? Seek the kingdom first, and he'll take care of your food, your raiment, your housing, everything.
So true.
But put him first, and you'll be taken care of. Just that simple. But he said, oh, ye of little faith. We got so much little faith. Well, I don't know if I'm going to make it this check. I need to go to the cash station alone or whatever. Checking the cash and all that other stuff. Yeah. I know that. Been there, done that. I know. But put your faith in the Lord and he will take care of you. Just that simple. Okay. Now, let's go to Nehemiah, the 13th chapter. Nehemiah 13. And we're going to pick it up at verse 4. Nehemiah 13 and verse 4. Go ahead.
And before this, mm-hmm. Eliashib the priest, having the oversight of the chamber of the house of our God, mm-hmm. was allied unto Tobiah. Uh-huh. And he had prepared for him a great chamber, mm-hmm. where aforetime they laid the meat offering, mm-hmm. the frankincense, and the vessels, mm-hmm. and the tithes of the corn, mm-hmm. the new wine, and the oil, mm-hmm. which was commanded to be given to the Levites, mm-hmm. and the singers, mm-hmm. and the porters, mm-hmm. and the offerings of the priests.
Now, all this stuff was supposed to be stored up for the priests, right? But they then took this part of the chamber and gave it to this guy named Tobiah. And he wasn't supposed to be in the temple at all because of his nationality. But because the priest was losing so much money, they said, we got to rent the place out. And they renting out the house of the Lord. And Ezra came in, Nehemiah came there and was mad. And he's going to clean it up. Okay, but go ahead.
But in all this time was not I at Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. For in the 2 and 13th year of Artaxerxes, king of Babylon, mm-hmm. came I unto the king. And after certain days obtained I leave of the king. Mm-hmm. And I came to Jerusalem. And understood of the evil that Eliashib did for Tobiah, mm-hmm. and preparing him a chamber in the courts of the house of God. Mm-hmm. And it grieved me sore. Uh-huh. Therefore, I cast forth all the household stuff of Tobiah out of the chamber.
Now, he came there and cleaned it up, didn't he? He didn't ask for no court or no eviction or nothing like that. He just put him out. Plain and simple. Okay, go ahead.
Then I commanded, and they cleansed the chambers, and thither I brought I again the vessels of the house of God with the meat offering and the frankincense. And I perceived that the portions of the Levites had not been given them. For the Levites and the singers that did the work were fled every one to his field.
They looking for some food. So they got to go out and work in the field because the people ain't taking care of them, so they got to work in their own field. They ain't supposed to have no inheritance in the land at all, do they? The people are supposed to be their inheritance and take care of them. Okay, but go ahead.
Then contended I with the rulers and said, why is the house of God forsaken? And I gathered them together and set them in their place. Then brought all Judah the tithe of the corn and the new wine and the oil unto the treasury.
Now, because the people want to do this thing. But when you see all this wickedness going on, you see what they're doing to the house of the Lord, then people back up off of it. And even the priest said, look, man, I can't stick around here because I can do this work voluntarily for a certain amount of time.
I gotta eat.
But soon my family got to eat. So I got to hit this field. So ain't nobody being taught the word of God. That's why he went to the rulers. And them the main one we got problem with because the book say your rulers are famished. Have no understanding. Plain and simple. Okay, but go ahead.
And I made treasurers over the treasury. Shelemiah the priest, and Zadok the scribe, and of the Levites, Pedaiah. And next to them was Hanan, the son of Zakkur, the son of Mattaniah. For they were counted faithful, and their office was to distribute unto their brethren.
Ain't that something? You could trust them, right? It wasn't like Judas with the purse, and he counted the money for himself. They took in the treasures from the people, the tithes and the donations and the free will offering, and they distributed as the people had need. That's the way things have to be done. But that's what the storehouse is for, right?
Right.
To take care of the people. Just that simple. Okay. Now, let's go to Mark the 12th chapter. Mark 12. And we're going to pick it up at verse 41. Because we established that the Lord said you're supposed to bring a tenth, right? And when you bring a tenth, that's the part of the tenth of your increase, okay? Mark 12 and verse 41. Go ahead.
And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld how the people cast money into the treasury. And many that were rich cast in much.
So now, because you got guys bringing, they bring this big old pail of money, right? And bringing in much stuff, whatever they offer. And the Lord just sitting there watching. Okay, go ahead.
And there came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which make a farthing. And he called unto him his disciples and saith unto them, verily I say unto you, that this poor widow have cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury.
Now, he said she cast in more than all the rich people. How could that be when she cast in a farthing, right? He gonna tell you. Okay, go ahead.
For all they did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living.
Ain't that something? Because she gave more than 10. She gave all she had. That's a faithful servant because she got faith in the Lord that whatever she put in, she gonna get back more.
That's right.
Right? So when she put in all she had, she got what coming back? Bountifully, right? Just that simple. But everybody else just put in what they supposed to put in. If you're a rich man, you got $10 million, you only put in one, that ain't no big thing to the Lord. You just pay the 10. Just that simple, okay? But now, let's go to 1 Kings, the 17th chapter. 1 Kings 17, just so you can see how the Lord will take care of you. 1 Kings 17. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 Kings 17. And verse, we got time. You know what? Let's start at verse 1. We're gonna just read a little bit more than what I got on there. Okay, go ahead.
And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word.
So now, the Lord has stopped rain for a certain amount of time. So you don't have no rain, you don't have no food, right? Go ahead.
And the word of the Lord came up to him, saying, get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be, that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there.
Now, who going to feed him?
Ravens.
Raven's gonna bring him food. You know what I thought about? What I thought about this? Somebody probably was cooking on their little grill, and he sent the Ravens over there to snatch their food and bring it over there to listen, right? I mean, it might be well done or close to well done, but he ate all this time until this brook was dried up. But the bird brought him what? Meat. So that means something had to be either already cut up and filleted or whatever, because they didn't bring no animal, they brought the meat. So just my thought, that's what I'm just thinking. Okay, go ahead.
So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord.
Uh-huh.
So he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, mm-hmm. that is before Jordan.
Mm-hmm.
And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning,
uh-huh.
and bread and flesh in the evening,
mm-hmm.
and he drank of the brook.
Ain't that something? How the Lord took care of him. Even during this drought, this man eating bread and meat. Okay, go ahead.
Verse 7.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass after a while,
mm-hmm.
as the brook dried up,
mm-hmm.
because there had been no rain in the land.
Mm-hmm.
And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying,
mm-hmm.
Arise, get thee to Zarephath,
mm-hmm.
which belongeth to Zidon,
mm-hmm.
and dwell there.
Uh-huh.
Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee.
So now you're going to find out why he said he commanded this widow woman to sustain him. Because the bottom line is, he's going to come to this widow woman, and she had her last meal. Okay, go ahead.
So he arose and went to Zarephath.
Mm-hmm.
And when he came to the gate of the city,
mm-hmm.
behold, the widow woman was there gathering of sticks.
Mm-hmm.
And he called to her and said,
mm-hmm.
fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel,
mm-hmm.
that I may drink.
Mm-hmm.
And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said,
mm-hmm.
bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thine hand.
Uh-huh.
And she said, as the Lord thy God liveth,
mm-hmm.
I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel,
mm-hmm.
and a little oil in a cruse.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, I am gathering two sticks that I may go in and dress it for me and my son,
mm-hmm.
that we may eat it and die.
Ain't that something? They're at the last part of starvation. She's going to finish this last piece so they can her and her son can eat and die. Now watch what this man of God tell her. Okay, go ahead.
And Elijah said unto her,
mm-hmm.
fear not.
Mm-hmm.
Go and do as thou hast said,
mm-hmm.
but make me thereof a little cake first.
Wait a minute now. I ain't got but a handful. And you want me to take and give it to you first? Now she had to know he was a man of God, and she had to understand the law. You take care of the priest, take care of the Lord's business, the Lord take care of you. But you know Israel, you know y'all would have said, hey, ain't no way. I'll give you some water, but that, you, that's it. Me and my son gonna eat and die, but what we gonna see what this lady did. Okay, go ahead.
And bring it unto me.
Mm-hmm.
And after make for thee and for thy son.
Uh-huh.
For thus saith the Lord God of Israel,
mm-hmm.
the barrel of meal shall not waste,
mm-hmm.
neither shall the cruse of oil fail,
mm-hmm.
until the day that the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth.
Uh-huh.
And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah.
Mm-hmm.
And she and he and her house,
mm-hmm.
did eat many days.
Ain't that something? Faith. And when the Lord commands you to do something, you do it. Or whether your spirit tell you not to, sometimes you got to say, oh, all right. And get that grudgingly out of it and just do it, right? Because when he told her what the word of the Lord said, she went on with it. Okay, go ahead.
And the barrel of meal wasted not.
Mm-hmm.
Neither did the cruse of oil fail,
mm-hmm.
according to the word of the Lord,
mm-hmm.
which he spake by Elijah.
Ain't that something? Not just took care of him, but took care of her and her household. Because of faith. Just that simple. Okay, now. Let's go to Acts, the fourth chapter. Because sometimes, you know, Israel, we can get together as a people and we can start, you know, running off with our mouth. I'm going to do this and we're going to do that and we're going to do this. And then all of a sudden, time come to go through with the vow. And Israel back up off of it. And we're going to see how the Lord look at that. Because we read the scripture where it says, don't make a vow and don't pay it. It's like to pay it, okay? Acts 4 and verse 32. Go ahead.
And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart, mm-hmm. and of one soul.
Uh-huh.
Neither said any of them that aught of the things, mm-hmm. which he possessed was his own.
Uh-huh.
But they had all things common.
So now, when all this group of people got together, they said, look, we just going to all live commonly. We're going to say, don't nobody own nothing. We're just going to live off of each other. Okay, go ahead.
And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus,
mm-hmm.
and great grace was upon them all.
Uh-huh.
Neither was there any among them that lacked,
mm-hmm.
for as many as were possessors of lands, mm-hmm. or houses sold them,
mm-hmm.
and brought the prices of the things that were sold,
mm-hmm.
and laid them down at the apostles' feet,
mm-hmm.
and distribution was made unto every man, mm-hmm. according as he had need.
Ain't that something? The people brought whatever they had, gave it to the apostles. If anybody needed something, the apostle took care of it. right? The same way we've been reading about all the time. Take care of the people, right? Now, hold you a mark here. We're going to come back to this. We're going to go to Matthew 6 chapter. Matthew 6. We come right back to this act, so just hold your marker there. Because I want to show you something, because people will say, well, you go to church, you're supposed to put in your tithes, and you're supposed to put it before a table, because you know how you, y'all been around a while. They put a table in the front, have you come around, and the preacher can see who's putting in what. Or you might have the $100 table and up over here, and under $100 table over there. They set you up so they know who's paying the money, right? So that's what they do, and or otherwise they have a weekly book, a weekly tithes book, where they'll show who paying what in the tithes, right? And people always in competition with each other saying, well, I'm going to beat our sister so-and-so next week. I'm going to get her this, she got me this week. But next week I'm going to get her. It's a competition for the pocket of the preacher. But let's see what the book say. Let's go to Matthew 6 and verse 1. Go ahead.
Take heed that ye do not your alms before men to be seen of them.
Now, what is your alms? Your tithes and your offering, right? Mm-hmm. So you don't do it to be seen of men. Okay, but go ahead.
Otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father which is in heaven.
Ain't that something? So how you supposed to pay your tithe? In secret.
That's right.
Right? Okay, go ahead.
Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets.
Ain't that something? So-and-so just gave $1,000,
right.
And I got this $1 million check here.
Right.
You done got your reward.
That's it.
All that don't mean nothing, right? And the Lord said, don't do it and sound a, blow a trumpet that you doing this donation. Okay, but go ahead.
That they may have glory of men.
Mm-hmm.
Verily I say unto you, they have their reward.
Now, who you want to reward you, the man or the Lord?
The Lord.
The Lord. Okay, go ahead.
But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly.
Ain't that something? Plain and simple. That's how you're supposed to do your alms before the Lord. Okay, now, let's go back to Acts, the second, fifth chapter. Acts 5. Because apparently this guy made this statement before all these guys, said, I'm going to make this donation. Then when the time came for him to make the donation, he said, well, I'm going to take a little bit back. And he thinking he taking it back from man and not the Lord. Acts 5 and verse 1. Go ahead.
But a certain man named Ananias was Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it.
Which means he said, look, babe, I know we said we was going to give it this amount, but we're going to hold back a little bit. And she said, okay. And she agreed to it. Okay, but go ahead.
And brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet.
Mm-hmm.
But Peter said, Ananias,
why
have Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Why has it remained? Was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God.
Ain't that something? He let them know. The Lord know what you said you was going to do, and then you're going to turn around and keep part of it back. But all you had to do was keep your mouth shut and keep your land and didn't say nothing, and you'd have been straight. Now the Lord finna collect. Okay, go ahead.
And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost. And great fear came on all them that heard these things.
Now, he dropped dead right on the spot. You know great fear came upon a lot of people. I bet wasn't nobody making no vows after that.
Right.
Everybody was quiet because they know this man just dropped dead. Okay, but go ahead.
And the young man arose, wound him up, and carried him out and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, tell me whether ye sold the land for so much. And she said, yeah, for so much.
Now, women, be careful now. If you back up your husband and against the Lord, you got a problem.
That's right.
Don't let your husband convince you to do something against God. Because now he's going to see how God going to collect. Okay, go ahead.
Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then she fell straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost. And the young man came in and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband.
Ain't that something? No funeral, no nothing. Because you lied to the Lord, you got to pay. Okay, go ahead.
And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things.
Now, I bet they kept their mouth quiet then, didn't it? Mm-hmm. You got to be careful what you're going to say you're going to do for the Lord and then back up off of it. Because the Lord does hear. People think they say things and he don't hear and he don't see. We got eyes everywhere. Okay, now, let's go to Philippians, the fourth chapter. Philippians 4, and we're going to pick it up at verse 10. Philippians 4 and verse 10. Go ahead.
But I rejoice in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me have flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned, and whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound.
So now, Paul said, you know, look, I know when y'all take care of me, I know when I got little, I deal with little. And when I got a lot, I know how to deal with a lot. Okay, but go ahead.
Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me.
Now, he can do it through who?
Christ.
Through Christ. So it ain't about money, it's about the strength that the Lord gives. Okay, but now, skip down to verse 16.
For even in Thessalonica, ye sent once and again unto my necessity. Not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account.
He said, not that I want a gift or you going to pay me something, but he desired fruit that abound to what? To your account. He's about the Lord's business. You take care of him, then it's your account that the Lord give you the reward for helping him out. Just that simple. Okay, go ahead.
But I have all and abound. I am full, having received Epaphroditus, the things which were sent from you, an odor of sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well-pleasing to God.
So now what you offer is a sacrifice well-pleasing to God. It's an offering. Okay, but go ahead.
But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus.
Ain't that something? You take care of him, the Lord will reward you. Because when you're supporting the ministry, the Lord will take that as pleasure and make sure it's a ministry that's doing the thing according to the word of God. Just that simple, okay? Now, let's go to Romans, the 15th chapter. Romans 15. Because everybody have an opportunity to take a part in the ministry, but in certain ways for certain people, okay? Romans 5, 15, I'm sorry, and verse 25. Go ahead.
But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints. For it hath pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor saints which are at Jerusalem.
So now these are strangers that are making a contribution that Paul can take back to Jerusalem for the poor saints in Jerusalem. Okay, but who's the poor saint? You. Okay, go ahead.
It hath pleased them verily, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles have been made partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things.
What's carnal? Money. So it ain't for the Gentiles to take over the service of the Lord. It's for them to contribute to the service of the Lord. And that's why he said for them to contribute in carnal things if they have been made partakers of their spiritual things. Just that simple. Okay, now. Let's go to Matthew, the 10th chapter. Matthew 10. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1 and then skip down to verse 5. Go ahead.
And when he had called all unto him, when he had called unto him his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease.
So now, who did he call the 12 disciples, right? Now we're going to see how they send them out. Okay, skip down to verse 5.
These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
So now, the only time Peter went to bring the the strangers in, is when he went to talk to Cornelius, right? Outside of that, the Lord told them, go not in the way of the Gentile. That's another thing that was set up by Paul to go deal with the Gentile. Okay, but go ahead.
And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, Cast out devils, mm-hmm. freely ye have received, mm-hmm. freely give. Provide neither gold, mm-hmm. nor silver, mm-hmm. nor brass in your purses, mm-hmm. nor scrip for your journey, mm-hmm. neither two coats, mm-hmm. neither shoes, nor yet stays, mm-hmm. for the workman is worthy of his meat.
So, I mean, on your journey, the people are supposed to take care of you.
That's right.
That's why they say don't worry about no money, no clothing, no raiment, no nothing. Make sure that when you go, and the people going to take care of you. Just that simple. And that's how it's supposed to be, right?
Yep.
We're on our way to Florida next week because the people took care of the business for us to get down there. And we'll travel everywhere as long as you take care of the business to get us down there. Because our job is to preach the word of God and take care of the people of God. Just that simple, okay? Now, did you finish that?
Yep.
Now, let's go to Luke the 10th chapter. Luke 10. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Luke 10. And verse 1. Go ahead.
After these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also.
So now these are not the 12 disciples. These are other 70 guys that the Lord sent out. Okay, go ahead.
And sent them two and two before his face into every city and place,
mm-hmm.
whither he himself would come.
Uh-huh.
Therefore said he unto them,
uh-huh.
the harvest truly is great,
mm-hmm.
but the laborers are few.
Uh-huh.
Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest,
mm-hmm.
that he would send forth laborers into his harvest.
Mm-hmm.
Go your way.
Uh-huh.
Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves.
Ain't that something? We going out as lambs, but it's a bunch of wolves out here. And but they got sheep clothing on. Okay, go ahead.
Carry neither purse,
mm-hmm.
nor scrip,
mm-hmm.
nor shoes, and salute no man by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And into whatsoever house ye enter,
mm-hmm.
first say, peace be to this house.
Uh-huh.
And if the Son of Peace be there,
mm-hmm.
your peace shall rest upon it.
Mm-hmm.
If not, it shall turn to you again.
Uh-huh.
And in the same house, mm-hmm. remain, eating and drinking such things as they give.
Because now, it ain't, like, see, people get confused with this scripture saying, well, if you come to our house, we can present you any kind of food. No. If I come to your house, I know you know the word of God, and I know you know the dietary law. And I ain't going to eat no swine because I wouldn't have been in that house in the first place. Because you would know what to present before us. That's why he say eating and drinking. Okay, go ahead.
For the laborer is worthy of his hire.
Uh-huh.
Go not from house to house.
That's another clue of another doctrine. Don't go from house to house. But he said go there because the people going to take care of you when you get there. And that's the way it always is. We get to go to out of town, the people have prepared food for us. Because they know we in our travel mode, we can't sit and stop and cook and prepare. We in motion to get to you. Just that simple. So that's how it operates. Okay, now, let's go to 2 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. Y'all got two more after this, and then we out of here. 2 Corinthians 11. And we're going to pick it up at verse 7. Go ahead.
Have I committed an offense in abasing myself that ye might be exalted,
mm-hmm.
because I have preached to you the gospel of God freely?
No, because people will challenge you, saying that, you know, you ain't doing this, you doing that, you did. And he let them know, look, y'all gonna come at me like that, and I'm preaching the word of God and ain't charging you.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to come at me like that. Okay, go ahead.
I robbed other churches,
mm-hmm.
taking wages of them,
mm-hmm.
to do you service.
Ain't that something? He just let them know, y'all don't appreciate. We come down here to teach y'all, and we took money from other churches to take care of this y'all business. You ain't put a dime in, but we here. Okay, but go ahead.
And when I was present with you,
mm-hmm.
and wanted, I was chargeable to no man.
Mm-hmm.
For that which was lacking to me,
mm-hmm.
the brethren,
mm-hmm.
which came from Macedonia supplied.
Uh-huh.
And in all things I have kept myself from being burdensome unto you,
mm-hmm.
and so will I keep myself.
And he said, so now you ain't got to worry about me, but I'm going to teach you the word of God, so now it's on you.
Mm-hmm.
to do what you need to do. But you ain't gonna be my burden, you're gonna be my problem. And that's where it is sometimes, because people don't appreciate it sometimes when you bring them the word of God, and now you ask them for a donation. I ain't got no money. You know, I flew all the way down here from so-and-so, and you ain't gonna put a nickel in the pot. So don't worry about it no more. The other people will take care of it. Now you've been taught, now it's on you. Just that simple. Okay, now, let's go to 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter. 1 Corinthians 9. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 1. Go ahead.
Am I not an apostle? Mm-hmm. Am I not free? Uh-huh. Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Mm-hmm. Are not ye my work in the Lord? Uh-huh. If I be not an apostle unto others, mm-hmm. yet doubtless I am to you. Uh-huh. For the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord.
Ain't there something? These people challenged Paul on a regular basis. We had to let them know what his position was, where he'd been, and what he's been doing. Okay, go ahead.
Mine answer to them that do examine me is this. Uh-huh. Have we not power to eat and to drink? Mm-hmm. Have we not power to lead about a sister, a wife, as well as other apostles, mm-hmm. and as the brethren mm-hmm. of our Lord mm-hmm. and Cephas?
Because now, sometimes people will look at you, and they'll put you on a pedestal like you ain't supposed to do certain things. Right. Like, this Brother Marlon over there, is he drinking some whiskey? And they put you on a pedestal like, you know, you ain't supposed to be doing that. You holy, Mr. Ewing. Well, you got a drink. That's why Paul said, can y'all eat and drink? I can't do nothing. And that's how people get sometimes. Yes, yes. They put you on that pedestal like, you ain't supposed to be doing that. You know, I play beanbag with the people at the center, and they said, is Brother Marlon playing beanbag? He supposed to be walking around with a Bible in his hand. He supposed to be holding this. He supposed to be doing that kind of stuff. God forbid we go back to that church. Because they put you up so high, and Paul let them know, I'm just normal as y'all. I could even have a wife. Because people will look at you and say, he's married? Isn't he supposed to be celibate? They put that stuff on you. I'm telling you sometimes, and I'm telling people all the time, we just like you. I put on my pants one leg at a time, and I got to go to the bathroom just like you do. Just that simple. Okay, but go ahead.
Or I only and Barnabas, mm-hmm. have not we power to forbear working?
What do you mean? Because you're supposed to take care of them in the ministry. And he said they have power to forbear working. Paul was a tent maker, wasn't he? So, but he came in and he worked because he said, I ain't chargeable to nobody. That's the same way I feel. I'm chargeable just as a small amount, but not a full amount. Because I can say, look, y'all keep y'all. I'm going to go back and do what I got to do. I won't be here as much, but I still keep my job. Just that simple. Because I love being a minister. I do. It's stressful, but I love it. Okay, but go ahead.
Who goeth to warfare anytime mm-hmm. in his own charge? Mm-hmm. Who planteth the vineyard mm-hmm. and eateth not of the fruit thereof? Uh-huh. Or who feedeth the flock mm-hmm. and eateth not of the milk of the flock? Uh-huh. Say I these things as a man, mm-hmm. or say of not the law the same also?
Now, he bring you scripture now. I done put it to the ministry now. You telling me I can't take from the ministry? Mm-hmm. He said, but the law says I can. He's going to tell you the law. Okay, go ahead.
For it is written in mm-hmm. the law of Moses, mm-hmm. thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of the ox that treadeth out the corn. Uh-huh. Don't God take care for oxen?
Now, if the ox going to pull and plow the field, and he got a bit of corn sitting on the side, he want to stop and eat it, let him eat. He plowing it. Right?
Right.
So he said, don't put a muzzle on his mouth so he just continually working, not getting no benefit. Don't muzzle his mouth. He want to stop and eat, let him eat. Same thing with the ministry. Okay, go ahead.
Or saith it all together for our sakes? Uh-huh. For our sakes, no doubt, mm-hmm. this is written, mm-hmm. that he that ploweth should plow in hope, uh-huh. and that he that thresheth in hope should be partaker of his hope. Uh-huh. If we have sown unto you spiritual things, mm-hmm. is it a great thing if we shall reap your carnal things?
He said the least we can get from you is a little money to take care of our business. He said, because we can do it because the law said it's obligated to us. Okay, go ahead.
If others be partakers of this power mm-hmm. over you, mm-hmm. are not we rather? Uh-huh. Nevertheless, we have not used this power, mm-hmm. but suffer all things, mm-hmm. lest we should hinder the gospel of Christ.
So now, because if y'all don't want to pay, don't worry about it. We'll suffer for Christ, and y'all ain't got to give us a nickel, because we'll get taken care of no matter what. Mm-hmm. Plain and simple. Okay, but go ahead.
Do you not know mm-hmm. that they which minister about holy things live of the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar are partakers with the altar? Mm-hmm. Even so hath the Lord ordained mm-hmm. that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel.
Ain't that something? Who's supposed to take care of the preacher? The people. That's what's set up in the Leviticus priesthood, right? From the beginning. Okay, but go ahead.
But I have used none of these things. Mm-hmm. Neither have I written these things mm-hmm. that it should be so done unto me. Mm-hmm. For it were better for me to die mm-hmm. than that any man should make my glory and void.
Ain't that something? He said he'd rather die than you to say, well, we took care of you, and we took care of you, so you ain't got no reward coming. Now, we ain't doing this for the work that you can pay us. We doing it to take care of the Lord's business. He's our reward, not your money. Okay, but go ahead.
For though I preach the gospel, mm-hmm. I have nothing to glory of. Uh-huh. For necessity is laid upon me. Mm-hmm. Yea, woe is unto me mm-hmm. if I preach not the gospel. Mm-hmm. For if I do this thing willingly, mm-hmm. I have a reward. Uh-huh. But if against my will, mm-hmm. a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me.
Now, ain't that something? You say he can do this thing without getting paid. But if you do it for pay, then you say that's a dispensation. That's a gospel committed unto him as not getting paid, not being taken care of from the Lord, right. Not man. Right. Okay, but go ahead.
What is my reward then? Uh-huh. Verily that. When I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, mm-hmm. that I abuse not my power in the gospel.
And that's what it's all about, not abusing it. Because you got people out here that abuse that power and take advantage of the people. Okay, but go ahead.
For though I be free from all men, mm-hmm. yet have I made myself servant unto all, mm-hmm. that I might gain the more.
Now, if you serve all people, you gain what? More. And not worried about no money. For every time you take care of the service of the Lord, you get a reward from the Lord. Plain and simple, okay? Now, let's go to Titus, the first chapter. Titus 1. And all these New Testament preachers should read this because apparently they're missing this one. And in fact, I know most of them know it's in here. Titus 1. And we're going to pick it up at verse 7. Go ahead.
For a bishop must be blameless, mm-hmm. as a steward of God, uh-huh. not self-willed, mm-hmm. not soon angry, mm-hmm. not given to wine, no striker, mm-hmm. not given to filthy lucre.
What's filthy lucre?
Money.
Money. Right? Because if you're in it for the money, then the Lord said you shouldn't be given to that. Okay, go ahead.
But a lover of hospitality, mm-hmm. a lover of good men, mm-hmm. sober, just, holy, temperate, mm-hmm. holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, uh-huh. that he may be able by sound doctrine mm-hmm. both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Mm-hmm. But there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, mm-hmm. especially they of the circumcision.
See, because there's a bunch of us out here, especially Israel, that are vain talkers and unruly. Okay, but go ahead.
Whose mouths must be stopped.
And we got a job. We got to shut their mouth because we got to bring the truth because they bring a lie. Okay, go ahead.
Who subvert whole houses, mm-hmm. teaching things which they ought not uh-huh. for filthy lucre's sake.
And what they doing it for?
Money.
Money. Teaching things that they ought not. And they do it all the time. And they still doing it to this day. But the bottom line is the duty, the Lord put it in your hand to take care of his tithing, and your free will offering is just a free will offering that you add to so bountifully so the Lord can reward you bountifully. Mm. So if you give a little, you're going to get a little. You give bountifully, the Lord will reward you bountifully. And that's why the tithe is to your accord. We don't pass no trays around. We don't do none of that because it is your duty to take care of the Lord's business. So that's the lesson, tithes and offering. I hope somebody got some understanding. Thank you for your time.